Thanks, Dan. Bless you, buddy. Bless you, bless you, bless you. Well, thank you so much, The Rock Church. You may be seated. It is an absolute delight to be here with you once again. We've just got the highest regard for this church. Last night we had dinner with Pastor Dan, and I'm just so deep under the impression that you are a blessed church with great leadership in this church. God bless you guys. You know, many years ago, when I was young and still had hair, I used to frequent this church with Pastor Jim and Pastor Deborah, and they had a profound influence on our lives because I saw a church that was doing outreach, reaching community, out in the prisons, doing stuff. And that so stirred my heart that we went back and started establishing that within our own church. And now God is giving us a platform to go all over the world and share this with other churches. And really, it was sparked by our exposure to the faithfulness of the leadership of this church. And we say thank you to you. And so it's always such a privilege for me to come to the church and share the word with you. I want to make you aware of a book that you can pick up after the service. It's called We Start at Finish. And you know, when Jesus was on the cross, the last words were, "It is finished." And then it all started for us. You see, Jesus has the last word. Many times there's a word that wants to give definition to people's lives, and it's keeping people in bondage. A word, just a word, divorce, single, shame, blame. A word can keep you in bondage. But can I just tell you, no word is strong enough because Jesus Christ has the last word. He has the last word. And when Jesus speaks, it changes. And he did make this statement, "It is finished." And in that statement, we were included. In that triumph and that victory that he established, we were included. You know, it's amazing when I come to the U.S., I become very aware of how strongly you feel about your sports team. I have watched you when your team wins. Something happens to the fans. They suddenly get an attitude. They don't walk, they move. Something happens to the way they think, they feel, they talk. When their team wins, it affects the way they engage life. And if you ask them who won, they would answer you, "We won." Say, "What do you mean we won? You did nothing, man." "No, hey, when they win, I win." Isn't it amazing that that recorded victory suddenly has a bearing on their lives and has an effect on how I think, how I speak, how I engage with people, the way I present myself is all now affected by a victory that has been recorded. Folks, listen, 2,000 years ago, a victory was recorded. It was established, and we are included in that reference. You see, his victory is my victory. His triumph is my triumph. Because he won, I win. I win. I have to discover how that victory defines my life. And this book was written to try and assist people to understand how to live from this completed work of Christ, the tetelestai, it is finished reference. And so you're welcome to pick that up. Only $10 and it's running fast. So don't go now, but after the service. It's amazing, you know, when we think about the life of Jesus. Jesus was so different. The way Jesus did life was different. The way he spoke was different. The way he engaged with people was so different. The way he navigated challenges was different. There was something unique about Jesus. When one of the disciples, John, is writing the Gospels, he's considering what he experienced in Jesus, and then he writes this phrase in John 1 chapter 4, when he's trying to capture what he remembered about Jesus, he says, "In him was life." And this life was the light to the world. There was something in Jesus that made him attractive. I mean, here is the holiest man on the planet, and the Bible says very bad sinners are attracted to him. They want to hang out with him. They see something in his life. They desire to have what he has. And John says, it's life. In him was life. And so Jesus is modeling this life. And he's so desired, and we see how he wants to lead the disciples through this discovery that whatever we were seeing in him, whatever we were appreciating about him, he was about to do something that we could share in the same quality of life. In John 10, verse 10, John quotes Jesus and he says, this was Jesus' mission statement. This is why he came to earth, where Jesus himself says, "I have come that you might have life." So Jesus literally saying, that what I have, that what you so desire and see in me, I have come to secure the reality that you could share in the same quality. Life. See, people, we are not in church just trying to adjust people's behavior. We're not just trying to make bad people better people. We're not just trying to have a program of behavioral modification. We're introducing people to life. It's about life. In Africa, we have lions. And I don't know if you've had the privilege of being close to a lion without a fence between you and the lion. But what we do in Africa is we have these safari vehicles and they don't have doors, so they're open on the side. And you sit on that vehicle and then you drive into this area and the lions roam freely. And it's an intimidating experience when that lion comes close. So recently, Liana and I are on one of these safari vehicles and we're in this park and the next moment, a lion starts walking towards us. I don't know if you've ever looked into the eyes of a lion. The blood in your body feels like it's draining out of you. And so this lion is... And the guy behind me has got a camera, and the camera is making a clicking sound, and the lion is intrigued by the clicking sound, and I'm saying to myself, I don't know if I'm about to die and if I'm about to kill someone. But when you look into the eyes of that beast, you recognize authority, you recognize power, you just sense nothing intimidates this animal. But when A lion is taken to a circus. And we're about to demonstrate that. When a lion is taken to a circus, something happens to that animal. It's as if the spirit of that animal, the essence of that animal is broken because something happens. It becomes an anxious animal. Because there's a man with a whip. And as the whip is cracking, that animal comes into the arena, starts running around, and then it does adjust its behavior. It starts doing tricks. And the people applaud, but that animal is just doing those tricks because it's afraid of the whip. And many times in our minds, we have thought about church and God's kingdom and being a Christian as if the Bible is a whip and we're trying to whip people into a behavioral modification. Listen, the bad thing is that animal only does that while the whip is there. When that animal goes back to its cage, it doesn't sit there and practice the tricks. Why? Because there's no more whip. But if you take that animal back and you put it into its habitat, into its environment, something happens to that animal. It becomes true lion. Folks, that's what we do. We're not standing here with a whip. We're introducing you to your true environment because in Him do we live and move and have our being. We are in Christ. Oh. And the moment you discover who you are in Christ, it changes your identity. You start thinking different about yourself, and identity precedes activity. Now you live different, not because you have a whip, but because you've discovered something. You've come into this environment. And this is what Jesus wanted to share with people. He wanted to share this with the disciples because the disciples were looking at him and saying, there's something different about you. Jesus, you talk different. You function different. You live different. You even pray different. When you pray, it sounds like you're speaking to the Father. And it feels as if you think the Father is close to you. You don't see God as far. You see, Jesus, even in John chapter 8, he makes this statement. He says, the Father and I are one. And then the people want to stone him. And Jesus says, why? Why do you want to kill me? What did I do? And they says, nothing because of what you did. It's because you are making yourself equal to God. Jesus is saying, hey, this is what I actually want to introduce you to because I want to show you that I'm living as one that is in proximity with the Father. No longer is God far. The disciples listen to him and they say, well, teach us to pray. And then Jesus calls them to him. And here in Matthew 6, verse 9, we see Jesus says to them, this then is how you should pray. Our Father in heaven, hallowed be your name. Your kingdom come. Your will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Here's the amazing thing. When Jesus teaches them to pray, he's not teaching them some rhyme, some prayer that will become a religious exercise through the ages. Jesus was saying, I want you to speak to the Father, and I know whatever you're saying to the Father, that will happen. So Jesus is saying, pray this way, and if you pray this way, it will become reality. It's amazing. Jesus meets these disciples exactly where they are. Because you see, in their minds, they knew God is
far. God is the creator God. God is the transcendent God. He dwells in the heavenlies. He's the creator God of everything. But they did not understand that this transcendent God desires to become the immanent God, to come and dwell with us, to come and share his very life in us. Jesus meets them where they are. Our Father who is in heaven. But then he says, let your kingdom come. Let your authority, your presence, your lordship, let your glory, let your fullness, let your kingdom come. Let it be on earth as it is in heaven. Jesus is saying, invite the Father. This is what you must pray. Pray, O Father, let your fullness come. You know, when I read this, I'm often reminded of people that are living with distance between each other. It's like, you know, grandpa and grandma are staying out here on the West Coast, and somewhere on the East Coast, the kids are, and their children are growing up. And so mom and dad create these moments for the kids to kind of, you know, just catch up and chat with grandpa and grandma. And so FaceTime and Skype and all these things are used, and the kids are there, the computer is set up, and now they're just engaging with grandpa and grandma. And while they're talking to grandpa and grandma, the mother kind of leans over and says, hey, tell grandpa and grandma it's time to come and visit. It's great that we can talk to them with this mechanism, but we want them here. And so when I read Matthew chapter 6, this is just Jesus saying to the disciples, hey guys, when you do the Skype call, when you pray, just ask the Father, come, O Father, and visit us. Come and dwell with us. Come close to us. This is what Jesus, this is the heart of what is communicated. And so right through as Jesus journeys with the disciples, he's trying to make them aware, hey, there will be a moment when all distance will be canceled. You'll have the privilege of relationship with the Father. And so just before Jesus dies and gives his life for this to happen, he calls his disciples together, and now he's speaking to them. This is just prior to him being crucified. It's the last things that he's communicating to the disciples. And you can feel the weight of this communication when Jesus engages them. And we read that in John chapter 14 from verse 1. And we're going to read quite a bit of scripture here. Jesus pulls the disciples together, and listen to what he says. Let not your heart be troubled. You believe in God, believe also in me. In my Father's house, there are many mansions. If it was not so, I would have told you. I go to prepare a place for you. And if I go to prepare a place, actually in the Greek there is no A, it's just I go to prepare a place for you. And if I've prepared a place for you, I will come again and receive you to myself, that where I am, there you may be also. And where I go, you know, and the way you know. All right, so Jesus, now the disciples, just see this picture, all right? The disciples are there, and Jesus is speaking to them, and he says, don't let your hearts be troubled. Believe in God, believe in me. I'm going to go and prepare place for you. And if I've prepared place, I'm going to take you to where I am. And where I'm going, you know where I'm going, and you know the way to get there. And the disciples, what? Jesus, you're leaving? You're going somewhere and you're going to... We don't know where you're going. It's like, I sometimes think Jesus, poor Jesus was saying, guys, I've been trying to explain this to you for 3 years. And here they are. We don't understand. And then Thomas, he's the honest guy. Thomas looks at this and he says, Lord, we don't know where you are going, and how can we know the way? And then Jesus says to him, I am the way, the truth, and the life, and no one comes to the Father except through me. Hey, isn't this phenomenal? Listen, Jesus immediately explains the place and he explains the way. He says, listen, the place is the Father. And the way to get to the Father is through me. I'm going to pay the price. I'm going to lay my life down. I'm going to say it is finished so that you can be reinstated in a relationship with the Father. Folks, can I tell you something? Part of our problem is we have made heaven the reward of Christianity. Heaven is not the reward of Christianity. The fact that we can once again be unified with the Father through Jesus Christ is the reward of Christianity. That's what changes our lives. That's what repositions us. And thank God for heaven, and thank God that in the eschaton, in the eternity, we will see him face to face and we will be as he is. But heaven is heaven not because there are streets of gold and pearly gates. Heaven is heaven because we will see him. It's about being restored to Christ and the Father. You see, if you grew up in the church as I did, and you read this portion of scripture, many of us, for some reason, were under the impression that Jesus was actually talking about him going away and building a building. And when he is finished, somewhere in heaven, he's busy with a massive building project. And the angels are working hard and everybody is busy to try and complete this project. And once this project is over, then Jesus is coming to fetch us. Folks, now that's not what the scripture says. The whole text is sharing something else. Listen, this is so important that you understand this. The God that we serve does not need 2,000 years to build a building. He creates with one word. Let it be, and it is. Jesus was talking about something else. He said, I'm gonna open the way. I'm gonna bring you to a place which will so deeply affect your life, that will so deeply arrest who you are. And so Jesus wants them to understand this. And so he says in verse 7, going on with this passage, he says, if you have known me, you would have known my Father also. And from now on, you will know him and you will have seen him. And Philip says to him, Philip makes this deep, religious, beautiful, naive statement that if you read it, you think, you know, he was really well intended. But Jesus rebukes him. Listen to what he says. Lord, show us the Father and it will be sufficient for us. Sounds so good. And Jesus looks at him and he says, have I been with you so long and yet you did not know me, Philip? For he who has seen me has seen the Father. Wow. So how can you say, show us the Father? Say, Philip, what you've seen in me, what you found so attractive, what you knew was so different about me, it wasn't just that I was such a wonderful individual. I had lived with the proximity of the Father, the fullness of the Godhead in me. You're attracted to something that goes beyond just the flesh and blood. You've seen something, and if you see me, you actually see the Father. Wow. And so Jesus wants to explain this, and I need some help now. Rian, would you come and help me hold the microphone? Thank you. I want to demonstrate something to you, and I brought some cups. Now, I have these four cups. These cups represent God the Father, God the Son, Jesus Christ, God the Holy Spirit, and us. Jesus continues to speak. Listen to what he says. Now, remember now the disciples. He's seeing this blurry reference with the disciples. He's trying to get them to truly understand what he was communicating. And he says, verse 10, do you not believe, this is Jesus speaking, that I am in the Father? And that the Father is in me. Wow, this was radical. You got to understand, Jesus is speaking to Jews. And the Jews, they could not fathom that a human being could make themselves so connected to God. Jesus says, he's in me. I'm in him. And then he carries on. He says, the words that I speak to you, I do not speak on my own authority, but he who dwells in me, he does the works. Believe me that I am in the Father and the Father in me. Or if you can't understand this, Jesus says, then just believe me for the sake of the works themselves. Just the fact that you're seeing I'm doing stuff so differently, listen, just accept it. There's something different about my life. And then Jesus says, verse 16, I will pray the Father, and he will give you another helper that he may abide with you forever. The Spirit of the truth, who the world cannot see, because it neither, or cannot receive, because it neither sees him or knows him, but you know him, for he dwells with you and will be in you. Wow. The problem is many Christians stop there. They're under the impression the Holy Spirit is in us, but Jesus and the Father, well, he's still, they're somewhere in heaven. They're far away. Jesus doesn't stop speaking there. Listen to what he says. I will not leave you as orphans. I will come to you a little while longer, a little while longer, a little. I did a study on the word little in Greek. It means little. Not 2,000 years, folks. A little while longer, Jesus says the following. He says, and the world will see me no more, but you will see me because I live and you will live. Oh, so powerful. At that day, at the day when all of this is happening, Jesus says, you will know that I am in my Father and you are in me, and I that am in the Father is in you. Whoa! Come on. Thanks, Rihanna. John 14, Jesus goes on in verse 23. He says, Jesus answered and said to him, if anyone loves me, he will keep my word, and my Father will love him, and we will come to him and make our home in them. Our home. His habitation, his dwelling place, in me. I am wall to wall full of God. Fullness of God is in me. He's come to dwell within me. He doesn't just come to visit. He's come to make his dwelling place, his habitation. He chose me as the place where he wants to reside. I have become the address of God. Isn't that amazing? I remember years ago, I was a young teenager. We had a visiting speaker from the U.S., a Spanish-speaking pastor, Jean Ortiz. And he came, and I was sitting in about the fourth row. And I remember looking at him when he made this statement. And I still recall his Spanish accent when he said, when God comes into your life, he does not just come to visit. He comes with all the luggage. It so deeply impacted me. God has moved in to my life. Why is this so important? Because you see, if you understand that God is in you, with you, residing in your life, it changes the way you engage life. It changes the way you talk. It changes the way you walk. It changes the way you think about challenges. It changes the way you speak to people. It changes your life when you live with the awareness, God is in me. I recently had to go to the bank because I had to do a transaction that was very complex and I needed the bank to finance some stuff. And as I was walking to the bank, I heard myself in my self-communication say, I don't think the bank's going to help me. And as I got to the door of the bank, I heard myself say, Ellen, you're wasting time. The bank is not going to listen to you. They're not going to help you. And the next moment, as clear as I'm standing here and saying, I hear God say to me, why are you walking into the bank like a loser? And I'm like saying, Lord, that's a little unfair. I think maybe you don't have all the information. Maybe if you understood how complex this deal was, you know, you. And I heard the Holy Spirit say to me, when you walk into this bank, lift up your head, put your shoulders back. Because the King of the universe, the Creator God, is in you. And when you walk in here, walk as a carrier of the glory of God. Walk as one that has the very residing presence of the Creator of the universe within you. And this is what I heard the Holy Spirit say to me. And whether the bank helps you or not, When you walk out of this bank, you must know that I, the God of the universe, will never leave you, never forsake you. I have committed myself to you. I am with you. Now, even if the bank manager says no, it's not intimidating me. It's not crushing me. I'm living as someone that says, then God, my security has another way. It's going to be another door. I walk with God within me. We have a lady back home. She lives in an apartment building, and her rent was up, and she couldn't pay that month, And so she tells the story. She says she goes into her apartment and shuts the door and she starts praying. And she says, Lord, I just want to tell you, your rent is up. Now that's good theology, man. Because you see, he's also staying there now. Hey, come on. It's a new way of thinking. It's a new way of living. It's a new way of engaging. You suddenly are aware God is with me. So often we live without the awareness of this majestic engagement with God. We have friends in South Africa that recently wanted to just take a bit of time out, and they went to the central part of the country where we have these majestic mountains called the Dragon Mountains, the Drakensberg. It's really a sight to see, and so they booked this little hotel, very excited, never been to the mountains before. And as they were driving up to the mountains, there was a thick fog that settled over that whole region. And they said as they drove up to the mountains, they could see nothing because the fog was too thick. So they were driving in and disappointed and went to bed. The next morning as they woke up, he said he drew the curtains. And as he drew the curtains, the fog had lifted. And suddenly he was looking at this incredible mountain range. Just overwhelmed by what he saw, he was looking at this mountain. He says, and then the thought occurred to him, this mountain didn't arrive during the night. It's actually been there all the time. He said the only problem was he couldn't see it because of the fog. You see, we have to understand God has made His residence in us. It's not just going to happen when I become aware of it. God is in me. If you're a child of God, He's made His residence in you. Many times, this world has so much fog. There's so much stuff. There's so many things that cloud our vision and life and just navigating the challenges of life brings this fogginess in our lives and we don't really see. I'm praying that this morning will just be a moment where God just takes away the fog. And where you just realize He is in me. He's made His residence in me. He dwells in me. He lives in me. Maybe you're here this morning as I close. You're hearing this word and you so desire that this would be a reality in your life, but you know you're far from God. You know that you don't even understand what all of this means when we talk about living with the awareness of God's presence in your life. Jesus said, He's the way. Because you see, He is the way because He paid the price. And every one of us that become aware of God in us have run to Jesus. And we've confessed our sin. And we've said, we need you, Jesus. We want to be included in that reference, the final word over our lives. And we can't close the service without allowing people the privilege of coming into relationship with the living God, accepting Jesus Christ as this sacrifice to take away all the fog of sin and shame and guilt and the stuff that keeps you away from this privilege of relationship with the Father. It's so sad when we see people living life so unaware of this privilege. Recently, we as a family were taking a trip here in the USA, and I was showing them some of the country, and we checked into a hotel, a very nice hotel, but I only booked the very basic rooms. And when we got there and we're checking in, the lady said, we have a bit of a problem. We can't put you in these rooms. We have to upgrade you. I looked at her and I said, I like that word. Upgrade's good. And so they did. They upgraded us to a room that was a phenomenal room, the top room in the hotel. It was amazing. You press buttons and curtains close and lights dim. And I mean, we were just enamored with this room. Stayed there for two nights. And as I was checking out, there was another lady that was helping us. And she looked at what had happened and she says, how did this happen? I said, what? She said, sir, you secured these rooms, but we put you in this room. And before I could help myself, I said, oh, it's favor. And she looked at me and she says, who did you the favor? I said, no, it's divine favor. And she looked at me and she said, sir, I want to tell you, this hotel and God have nothing in common. When she said it, it hit me. Here is a life that lives her life every day, so unaware that God could be with her, that God's presence could flood her life, and that she could live within the smile and favor and grace of the Creator of heaven and earth every day of her life. If you came in here today and you know, you have no idea what it is to live with God's smile upon your life. But you're ready to respond and you're ready to say, Lord Jesus, I want to run to you. I want to lay my life down and I want to accept the sacrifice that was paid for me so that I can be included. We're going to pray for you. We're going to trust God that in this moment there will be a transformation where the Bible says you will move from death to life. You will partake in life. And so I want to invite you. If you're here today and say, that's me, you can feel it here in your innermost being. There's something that's stirring within you and you're saying, I know it's me. I'm going to ask you to respond to that. And at the count of three, I'm going to ask you to raise your hand if you are saying, that's me. Please pray for me. So if you want to be included in this prayer to come to Jesus Christ today, I'm inviting you to raise your hand at the count of three. One, two, three. Please raise your hand. Thank you. God bless you. God bless you. If there's anybody else that says, I know I should have raised my hand right now, please just raise it real quick and say, yes, just include me in this prayer. Thank you. So desire that you will experience this life and abundance. Thank you. God bless you. I'm going to ask you, if you've raised your hand, to take another step and publicly declare that you're serious about what you've just said. I'm going to ask you to stand up and walk out and come stand right in front here, because I want to pray for you and speak the life of Christ over your life. Let's praise God as these people come forward. Just walk out immediately, come down, stand over here, and we're going to pray with you.
Forever I will run and unto you, O God. Where else can I go? So I will run.
Hallelujah.
Forever I will run and unto you, O God. Where else can I go?
Oh, thank you, Jesus.
I will run. Forever I will run.
Praise be upon you. Oh, the Bible says there's rejoicing in heaven right now. Angels are rejoicing because people have committed to this incredible moment. And we trust God that your life will never be the same again. That you truly will experience what it is to go from death to life. To experience the presence of the Almighty God in your life. I'm going to pray for you and receive in this moment just the grace of God over your life. Father, in the name of Jesus, we thank you for the awesome privilege of this moment and seeing these people respond. So now we pray, Lord, that they would sense that the power of darkness, of sin and shame is broken over their lives, and that they could confess and say that Jesus Christ becomes the reference of my life. Jesus Christ now defines who I am. Lord, I thank you that the blood of Jesus Christ in this moment cleanses every single one of them of everything that has burdened them, that has darkened their lives, that has affected their lives. We thank you that the blood has power, and that in this moment there is release, and that there is victory, and that the grace of God will be evident in their lives. We thank you. We thank you. So be glorified in their lives in this moment, Lord. In Jesus' name we say thank you. Amen. 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 Now, guys, this is an incredible decision. It's probably the biggest decision. Not probably, it is the biggest decision you can ever make in your life. And therefore, we don't want to play with this decision. We want to make serious about what you've just decided. And so we want to put something in your hand. We want somebody just to personally lay hands on you and pray with you. So would you please just go, one of the pastors right there, Pastor Joel, would you just walk with him? It's going to be about 3 minutes that they will spend some time with you. God bless you. Let's give God a hand as they